Wait a minute! Didn't we do this already? I bind you, Donald, from doing harm. Harm against other people and harm against yourself. I bind you, Donald, from doing harm. Harm against other people and... Oh, you're back. Great. Welcome, boils and ghouls, to another episode of Damien's Dreadfuls. As always, I am your ever-so-charming host, Lord Damian MacDonovan. And I apologize for that little bit of deja vu, but I didn't think we would be getting to a sequel to one of our previous episodes so quickly. Plus, with everything that's been going on since January, I felt a binding was in order. You know, some people have suggested that I leave politics off the show, but, well, it's my show and we're here to talk about monsters. Anyway, where were we? Oh! Right, a sequel. Yes, creeps, tonight's film is the even less regarded than the original Revolt of the Zombies, the 1936 sequel in theme only to 1933's White Zombie. I mentioned this film in our previous presentation of White Zombie last season, but if you remember that episode, you already know that there will be no Bela Lugosi in our feature tonight. Well, he's kind of there, but we'll get into that later. No other original cast members return either, and the plot really has nothing to do with the first one, except for the zombies, and even that's debatable. Fortunately, the film is rather short, so to make up for the LOL, a term here meaning lack of Lugosi, we are going to fill in some time with another episode of Bela's 1939 serial series. So, let's get tonight started with The Phantom Creeps, Chapter 4, Invisible Terror.
Thank you. I'm gonna try to open this thing.
Don't open that.
What's the matter, Bob? Can't you make it?
No, not yet.
Well, maybe it's just as well after what happened to that neometer. Hey, Bob. Well, what's the matter with this car? The engine stopped running. Plenty of gas.
Hey, Bob! Run a down brake, keep her rolling!
Just that block before we all get blown to bits.
Who was it?
Did you get that guy's license number?
I sure did. 130,000 volts. That's what wrecked us when I fooled with that gadget on the box.
Boy, that was a close one.
I better see if the box is still there.
Yeah, I'm going after that guy we picked up in Zorka's lab.
Well, this is no time for a manhunt. It's more important we get that mystery box to the federal lab for an analysis.
Blow up the whole city?
I guess you're right. We'll take it to Dr. Mallory's house. It'll be safer there. We're not the only survivors. The box is still here.
Guy get away. He's one of the spy ring.
The police will catch him. He can't get far with that bullet.
Say, what's going on here? You fellas trying to electrocute yourselves? Who's driving that car?
Take it easy.
Okay, Captain West.
We have to get to Dr. Mallory's right away. Official business.
I'll give you a lift.
All right, thanks. We'll tell you all about it on the way.
You will be the instrument of my vengeance.
So you decided to come back, did you?
The federal men broke in. They carried me off. They stole the meteor.
You're lying. I left you on guard and you betrayed me.
You've sold the source of my power to my enemies.
No, I swear it.
And why did you remove that box from the secret vault?
I heard voices. I thought strangers were coming to steal it.
I shall show you what happens to those who cross me.
Don't let him get me! I'm wounded! I'm shot! I swear I'm not lying! Look!
Tell me what happened. Come.
Put up your sleeve. Put your arms to the tube in front of the ray.
Take your arm out.
You hurt nothing.
Not a thing.
Painless surgery. This and 1,000 greater powers are possible with the secret element. And now the source of it is gone. They shall not keep it. No government shall possess my power. I know where Bob Best has taken my meteor.
But I can't go with you. They know me now. If I'm taken, they'll throw me back into Alcatraz. You can make yourself invisible.
The Phantom will continue to protect you.
Thanks, officer.
The newspaper nemesis.
What's in the box?
Lunch for Dr. Mallory.
Maybe he'll swallow that, but not me. Listen, my editor's putting the pressure on me for a story. Is that one of the late Dr. Zorka's gadgets?
Look, Miss Drew, the safety of this country depends on the contents of this box. There are spies in the city paid to see Zorka's secret.
Here comes Brown now. A G-man just carried a box into Mallory's house.
Okay, I'll call the chief and tell him he's at the airport. You get back and watch the house.
Why don't you soft-pedal yours for sensational headlines where we tell you differently?
Well, all right. On condition that I get the scoop when you're ready.
Hello, Dr. Miller.
Hello, Bob. Good. You found something.
Something. It's dynamite.
Come in.
Oh, if you don't mind, Miss Drew, I would prefer that only Captain West and Lieutenant Daly come into the laboratory.
Miss Drew has made her peace with the government.
Just the same, I'm afraid I'll have to exclude the press from this interview.
Go on, young lady. Take a walk.
There's two sets of prints on this box other than ours. Zorka probably handled it while he was alive, and the others must have belonged to the fellow who got away. Jim, take these down, will you? X-22-37.
Wait. This is the source of Zorka's element. I'm certain of it. The neometer is reacting exactly as it did to the disc we found on Miss Drew.
Wait here, Monk.
I might be able to extract Zorka's element from this material if I had time enough and the right equipment.
It took Madame Curie 14 years to isolate radium.
Zorka's equipment's probably still in his lab. Why don't you work there?
tell you what, Mallory, I'll take you to Zorka's myself. Personal escort service.
What's that? Well, either this place is haunted or I am. All right, Jim, you take Dr. Mallory to Zorka's. I'll follow along as soon as I talk to the office.
Well, you better make your call from outside. His wires have been tapped. Come on, Doc.
Thanks. Drive to the laboratory. Mallory is playing directly into my hands.
I'll meet you at Zorka's.
The federal boys just left for Zorka's house. They've got the box with them.
Okay, we'll head for our airport. The chief has a plane ready for our getaway.
Long distance? This is Captain West, DMI, calling the War Department, Washington, D.C. Reverse the charges. Very urgent.
You know, I don't feel any too comfortable with that thing so close.
Nothing can happen as long as the meteorite is not exposed.
Car is still trailing us.
Get off the road and out of sight when we round that curve ahead.
All clear.
Wait a minute, there's somebody in the back. All right, come on, buddy, climb out.
Oh, please, no, wait a minute.
Oh, you're a lot of help. Just a hitchhiker, Doctor.
Can I go along with you? Be a good scout.
Go on, bait it. Look, that car is coming fast. Whoever's in that car knows we've got the meteorite. All right, get in. Stay down.
Getting soft-hearted, huh?
Now quit the wisecracking. There's trouble coming.
We don't want gunfire while we're carrying that box.
Keep your hands where they are. First, the guy at the wheel. Who's in the back? All right, come on, get out, you. That's what we're after.
Be careful. If you drop that, we'll be blown to bits.
Don't take the lid off while I'm around, either.
Put that in our car. Handle it carefully. All right, start driving. And don't forget we're behind you, so don't get funny.
I can't. I've lost the keys.
All right, wise guy. Pile out, all of you. We'll take you in our car. Come on, get moving.
Jack thought these with my elements and planned them along the doorstep. But the disc? When our friends Captain West and Dr. Mallory walk in, no disc will be necessary. The meteorite they are carrying contains enough magnetism to attract thousands of spiders. They should be here soon. Something has gone wrong. They should be here by now.
Would you care if they had an accident?
Idiot. With those fools handling it, the meteorite is liable to explode, and I shall lose it. I shall wait no longer. This meteor will lead me to my meteorite. Come.
Line him up there, facing the wall.
One of you is Dr. Mallory.
I am.
I'm sending you on a little air journey. We need a scientist of your caliber to handle Zorka's discovery.
Warm up the motors. Why, you can't take off now with that fog rolling in.
Fog or no fog, we're leaving. Put that box in the plane.
No use hoping Bob will come now. If we get out of this, we'll have to do it ourselves.
Worse than dynamite.
Watch me and get ready to run.
Look out, you girls, Hollis! Don't you realize that you might have blown this to bits? This thing's a fake. You blockheads! I sent you to get the source of Zorka's element. Where'd you get this?
The girl gave it to us.
Extremely clever, young lady. But we're after the source of Zorka's element and we intend to get it. Where's the original box?
I'd like to know the answer to that one myself.
All right, Smith. Go to the back road and make a thorough search of their car. Take Mallory with you. You open the doors.
You are, creeps. How was the Phantom? I'm glad we could get a little bit of Lugosi in tonight, since he isn't starring in our feature presentation. Supposedly, he was originally supposed to be in the film. In September of 1935, it had been reported that Bella was supposed to star in what was going to be a sequel to White Zombie. I'm assuming he was going to reprise his role as Murder Legendre. That's Legendre, not Legendre, as I so haplessly mispronounced in our prior episode. Anyway, by November, it was announced that the Halperin brothers were going to be making the film, but there was no mention of Lugosi being involved. A camera crew was sent to Indochina to film background shots, but the movie was already behind schedule when they finally got started on production in early March of 36. I haven't been able to find out exactly why Lugosi wasn't in the film, but he is still kind of there. You see, anytime anyone in the film uses powers of mind control or hypnotism, you'll see that shot of Lugosi's eyes superimposed over the scene, just like in the original movie. Revolt of the Zombies actually stars Dean Jagger, Dorothy Stone, Roy Darcy, Robert Noland, George Cleveland, E. Alyn Warren, and Carl Stockdale. The plot takes us clear across to the opposite side of the planet as we follow a team of soldiers just after World War I, who are in Angkor to find and destroy the secret of making zombies. Which is a strange location, given that zombies are and were historically associated with Haitian voodoo. I'm not personally aware of any zombie equivalent in Cambodian mythology, but it's not really my area of expertise. Anyway, a love triangle ensues between members of the team, and one travels down a dark path, seeking secrets of zombification for personal gain and revenge! Well, let's get started with tonight's feature presentation. Here on Damien's Dreadfuls is the 1936 Halperin Brothers film, Revolt of the Zombies.
Captain Lou, your splendid service as an interpreter is appreciated. But when you try to tell me stories of mesmerism, occultism, men without souls, hordes of supermen capable of annihilating armies of trained men, you make me wonder which of us is sane.
General, I dare say I failed in my presentation of the facts.
No, not facts, but the ravings of a mad Cambodian priest. No, Luke, it's too fantastic. Read that last.
General Headquarters. Austrians bringing up veteran shock troops.
One moment. I wish I could believe in your robots. I could use several regiments of them right now. That's all.
Yes, sir.
You don't have to tell me you failed on one. I can read your emotions in your face just as easily as you read the dead languages.
You can't find a language in which to convince General Duval.
No, the chances are you apologized, stammered. He barked, and you retreated without firing a shot.
Wish I had your assurance, faculty of knowing your objective and driving straight at it.
Well, it's simple. Just impress the other fellow that you know more than he does.
It has been called ego, Cliff.
Oh, yes, but I like the American phrase better. Intestinal fortitude.
Don't rub it in.
Well, someone should. You know, I admire your knowledge and you envy my ego. Well, I'll take half your knowledge and you take half my ego and we'll have two smart men.
How much of this high priest story do you believe?
Oh, I think there is such a thing as black magic. Call it superstition if you want, I don't know. But I don't believe that you can turn human beings into automatons or, as you call them, zombies.
Do you believe in mental telepathy?
Might be something to it, I don't know.
Well, science does. It's an established fact, Cliff, that in the Orient, the last of an ancient race lives by the laws of telepathy. Their knowledge, their rituals, They're guarded by just such priests as this man, Tion.
All right, I'll buy your tribal medal, telegraphist, but I'll not buy your robots.
Now, look, Cliff. Tion here comes from Angkor, where, according to their legends, Angkor was built by these robots. Thousands of tireless, feelingless human machines.
Yes, yes, I know, and they call them zombies.
Controlled and directed mentally by their priest king.
Yes, and Tion here is the last descendant of that priest king and the only man alive that knows the secret of the zombies.
Tion. Bakan oi tava.
Bakan an Tion. Nya oi tang tonai.
I don't believe a word of it.
He says that the general keeps his ears in the ground like the ears of a corpse. That he'll not listen to the words of wisdom.
Well, what does he want to do? Get the general some earphones?
Eva pray Attilai.
Atek Shang. Shang Vatoi Akipuila.
Tiong still insists his gods say he must create zombie soldiers. He says he'll show us how a handful of zombies can take an entire enemy trench.
I'm not here to plead the cause of the Central European power, but that of modern civilization. In the name of humanity, you must not go further with your experiment. It may mean the destruction of the white race.
General von Schelling, the responsibility is not ours. It is that of a fanatical Oriental priest attached to our Cambodian contingent. We have already placed the man under arrest. His experiment ends with that.
I thank you, sir. I shall be glad to return with that assurance.
Then we are agreed that since the priest Tiong refuses to reveal his secret, he is a menace so powerful that he must be confined where he never again can use his occult knowledge.
Quite right, General. Right?
I suppose so.
I am in accord.
Sir, your threat of life imprisonment apparently has not moved this man.
He understands it means solitary confinement?
Yes, sir, and he still refuses.
Then inform him that we are forced to carry through the sentence of solitary confinement for life.
Yes, sir. Here. Bakan etoy va.
He is to be confined to his quarters pending his removal to military prison.
Yes, sir.
On guard.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, the priest Tiang was murdered. Murdered by someone who did not want the Allies to benefit by his power to create robot soldiers. Or perhaps by someone who tried to take the secret from him to become the greatest force in the world.
True. When dealing with these Orientals, you deal with fatalists. Death to them is a transition to a better life. Thoroughly understandable.
But his method of creating these zombies must be on record somewhere.
So I believe, sir. And it could only be in one of the temples of Angkor.
Then we must find it. And when this war ends, our duties will not end with it. I make a suggestion. And ask that each of you bring it to the attention of your government. Urge them to sponsor jointly an expedition to the lost city of Angkor. And for general appearances, let it be a private expedition. Find the secret of the zombies, destroy it. Then we shall have to fix them.
Permit me to say so, sir. I think we've accomplished a good deal. It took years to make Angkor what she is. Certainly, we can't expect her to divulge her secret to us in just a few months.
Yes, but this all costs money,
darling.
Mr.
Mac, how do you like me in this helmet?
My dear Claire, I like you in anything.
You're a gallant. I think I look awful in it.
So do I.
Now, Daddy, this is the time you're not to agree with me.
Well, maybe someday I'll say something that meets with your approval.
I promised myself that, darling. Say, Luke, how do you like me in it?
In what?
This hat. Copper. This.
I think you're beautiful.
Sure. You're more than gallant.
I beg your pardon,
Oh, now you've spoiled it.
Is this the discussion of business, or are we playing charade?
Proceed, gentlemen. I'll take the minutes to see you.
Now, Claire, now, here, I...
Son, am I intruding?
Well, you're late.
Sorry. I was busy.
Oh, you were?
Yes.
Well, that's interesting.
Monsieur Luke, no doubt, has represented me well, I trust.
Well, he made some alibis for you.
That's very nice of him, I'm sure. But I have a habit of handling my own affairs.
I'm looking things over today.
Well, I'll be pleased to accompany you. Perhaps Mademoiselle Duval will permit me to...
Thank you, monsieur. I've made my arrangements. Monsieur Luke has consented to act as my guide.
I see.
In an hour, Monsieur Luke.
Thank you, Mademoiselle Duval. None whatever. So he promised to give up his power, release his subjects for this woman he loved.
Now, that's my idea of a man in love.
You believe the legend?
Who made it up, old Ankavar or you?
It's a true translation of the legend.
Would you have given up all that power for Endra?
I shall never have power. And I've never known love.
Well, power's not so important. When you are in love. In love with old stones and pieces of pottery. Well, perhaps you're lucky.
Perhaps.
Who's that?
Oh, that's Cliff Grayson. He's one of our best men here.
Uh-huh. I'm hungry. Let's go back to camp.
All right, let's do.
What did you say his name was?
Jakob Armin.
Oh, no, I mean him.
Oh, Cliff Grayson. I thought for a while she was in love with you.
That shows what imagination can do.
I could have understood that.
Why?
You're so much more her kind.
There goes that inferiority complex again. You know, someday I'm going to cure you of that.
I hope you do. What was it you said once about if you want anything, ride roughshod
shot over everything. Be ruthless. Forget all sentiment. Get to your objective, take it, and hold it.
I wonder if I could do that.
Perhaps not. But the man that doesn't is a fool. Good night. No. Dance is centuries old, I expect.
Yes, but the wiggle's always the same.
That's the traditional wedding dance of the Khmer's.
You know, she had a nice...
Father?
Understanding of the dance.
Now, Father, that girl is my discovery.
This engagement party would not be complete without hearing from the lucky man. On your feet, lad. Let's see you rise to the occasion.
Well, I hardly know what to say. I suppose that no man hardly knows what to say in a situation like this, but I presume we all say just about the same thing. So, as trite as it is, may I say, I am the most fortunate man in the world.
Bravo!
I'm sorry. I must be overcome by Armin's emotions.
Well, I don't know what I'm supposed to say. What father does when he's giving up the only daughter he ever had?
You couldn't say anything nicer than that, darling.
I've said the right thing at last. I'm improving.
Mr. Grayson, you were about to say something. Were you not?
No, General. Like you, I prefer to listen tonight.
Oh, that's strange. I've never known you at a loss for words.
I wish you all the happiness that you deserve.
Puzzle together, isn't it?
Isn't it? I'm always wondering where the next piece goes.
First thing we know, Claire, you'll be a puzzle jigger like us with a sieve and a shovel.
Who knows? I might be the one who finds the secret of hypnotizing subjects. I know certain people I'd use it on.
Will you tell us if you find the secret?
Oh, she'd have to. A woman isn't supposed to keep a secret, is she?
I don't know whether Malatesta is painting this plot or trying on next year's color scheme for gentlemen's hair.
Understand it. I examined those ropes myself only this morning.
You think you're badly hurt?
I don't know. I'm just numb.
We'll get you to the hospital tent.
One thing I've always admired about you was your honesty.
The thing I've most admired about you was your loyalty to your work and to your friend, Cliff Grayson.
I've never had reason to question his loyalty either. Even now, he's an innocent victim, as I am.
I loved him.
And I loved you.
So did he. But do you think he would ever have admitted it? Unless I...
Unless you had used me to excite his jealousy.
Exactly.
I suppose in your mind you can justify that.
A woman in love can justify anything.
Be ruthless. Ride roughshod over everything. Forget all sentiment. Decide upon what you want and get it, no matter whom it hurts. I've been told that was the thing to do. And now I find it's a woman's code, too. Well, I still admire your honesty.
Oh, I have a regret. I've hurt you.
Well, you should have no regrets. If getting what you want is everything, there should be no regrets.
Oh, aren't you being a little ruthless now?
No. I'm a man who loves you.
Even now?
Yes. I shall always love you. I have been made somewhat ridiculous, it's true, but still I love you.
Oh, I'd much rather that you'd hate me.
I wish I could. That would make things so easy.
Had you done this to me, I should hate you. If for no other reason, because of pride.
Where you are concerned, I have no pride.
Hello again, boys and ghouls. Lord Damian MacDonovan back here again with our presentation of Revolt of the Zombies. I miss Bella already. 20 minutes into this thing, I haven't even really established a villain yet. Of course, the lack of character establishment and development was the least of this film's problems. It almost never even saw the light of day. During post-production, the Halperin brothers were hit with a legal suit by Amusement Securities Corporation, a group that had helped them fund the original White Zombie. The suit alleges that they owned all rights to use of the word zombie in motion picture titles. They even sent letters to theaters planning to show the film, warning them of financial and legal repercussions should they do so. A judge ruled, however, that the theaters could continue to show the film until a judgment in the suit was finalized. In the end, the Halperin brothers and their new producers had to shell out royalties to the plaintiff under the judgment that while ASC did not have exclusive rights to the word zombie, the new film was intentionally trying to capitalize on the previous one and would be attempting to compete with it, since they had decided to re-release White Zombie into theaters that same year. How convenient. Well, at least the decision didn't give ASC sole rights to the word. I mean, what kind of cinematic world would we be living in if we couldn't use the word zombie? Although that might account for the fact that one of the traditional rules of a zombie film is that you don't actually call them that. I mean, that rule gets broken more and more often these days, though. But then, modern zombies aren't really these types of zombies to begin with. I've talked about that before, I'm sure of it, so I won't bog you down with yet another lecture on the history of ghouls in cinema. You know what, let's just get back to this movie for now. How about that?
Ambassador to the Khmer Kingdom of Angkor witnessed a strange ceremony, which... Fools. Fools! Under our very noses. The secret does lie in Angkor. Luna, we're going back to Angkor. I want you to go with me.
No, sir. Do not go to Angkor.
Why not? Why not?
Please. Please to hold a very old religious... custom, because they glad you all go away. Very dangerous to go back. Thank you.
just like the picture.
I can't translate that.
Where's Luke? He's been absent now for 2 days without permission. And right in the middle of this important translation, he disappears into thin air.
And none of you, not one of you, are able to offer an explanation. I'll have discipline in this organization if I have to send every one of you back to your own country.
Well, here, Luke. Where have you been?
In Angkor.
By whose leave did you absent yourself from your work?
Well, I thought that you would be glad to know that...
You thought? You are incapable of thought. Did I give you permission to go to Angkor for 2 days while your work here, insignificant as it is, waits while I wait?
But Dr. Trevisan, I
will not tolerate insubordination. When you signed with this expedition, you agreed to abide by its orders. See, Luke, you are dismissed. You will be provided with transportation back to France on the next steamer leaving Saigon.
But, Doctor...
Good day, sir.
Sit down. There. Una, the white man's ways have ever been strange to you at least. To me, they are strange too. But I've discovered that he who would succeed must disregard all sentiment, decide upon his objective and drive straight to it. Ruthless? Yes, but therein lies success. Una, I have discovered the secret formula of the great king of the Khmer's. You are my first experiment. If I succeed with you, I will have acquired a knowledge that will make me the most
the most important man in the world. I will it. Hand or foot, except as I will it?
No, master.
Can you think or speak except as I command?
No, master.
Una, we're learning to be ruthless.
Yes, master.
Armand, you're a different man. There's no indecision in you these days, lad. You have an authority about you. It's quiet, but one senses it. Like a man who had suddenly found himself.
Took me a long time to acquire it. I no longer question what I should do. I do what I want to do.
That's fine. But there's always one danger of overdoing it. And that's worse than not doing it at all.
MacDonald, you're the one man to whom I'm grateful. You're my friend.
I always believed in you, lad.
I know you did.
If you hadn't said what you have, I wouldn't say this. I liked you for the way you stood on your feet when another man had the good luck that you deserved.
It wasn't for me.
That's the way to look at it. She's a grand girl, and he's a good lad. And we'll all be wishing him happiness in another 2 weeks.
Weeks.
I shouldn't, lad. Yes.
You will proceed at once to Istanbul. Report to Colonel Lamont, in charge of our survey in that district. Bring back his confidential finding. Take what escort you need.
Yes, sir, I appreciate the confidence you place in me, sir, but isn't this rather an unexpected mission, considering the fact that your daughter and I are to be married in 2 weeks, and the trip to Estella will take 6?
I sympathize with you, Grayson. But our duties come first. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Your poet Bobby Burns has said, the best laid plans of mice and men gang after glay.
Ah, welcome back, my little crypt kickers. Well, we finally established that our main character is, in fact, the villain of the story. You know, despite the flaws of the film, I have to give it that much credit. Revolt of the Zombies is almost more of a character study than it is a true horror film. We follow this man through heartbreak and turmoil to swearing revenge. It's almost more of a supervillain origin story. But again, it has little to nothing to do with the previous movie. Honestly, if this had been set earlier, and they had done more with the General Mazovia character, this could have been a prequel, and Mazovia could have gone on to become Lugosi's character later on in White Zombie. I mean, there's no way that Murder Legendre is the guy's real name. Come on. But after what they do with him here, that wouldn't be possible. Oh, spoilers. Oops. Anyway, you know what? Let's get back to the film and finish him off. Finish this thing off. Sorry.
Yeah. Bonsoir, monsieur.
Dr. Faustus, with his alchemy, and the help of his satanic majesty, discovered the secret of renewed youth. Just what is the secret you found?
I have not as yet been able to enlist the help of Satan, but perhaps you, with your recently acquired habits of appearing at inopportune moments, hold the power to materialize the Prince of Darkness.
In possession of the knowledge you hold, I should not need his help.
You assume much, my dear Mazovia.
I know much, my dear Luke.
You should know, then, that I'm not easily fooled by your attempted subtleties. Any knowledge that I may possess shall be retained only by me. You see, I don't hold you to be a stupid man.
You have need of me, my dear Luke. You are a clod. I, a man of imagination. You have stumbled upon this lost knowledge of the centuries. I have hesitated at nothing to gain it. Let me share your secret with you, and the world lies at our feet.
In France, did Tion, the high priest, share his knowledge with you?
No. And therefore he died.
You killed him?
With the help of the goddess Siva. Ah, that you will not understand. This you may, the breaking of the scaffold, so well tested by MacDonald, the mysterious disappearance of Francois and Henri, the refusal of the natives to do any further work.
Why?
The expedition withdrew, did it not? I knew you would not give up. I hoped you would lead me to the secret. Tiang took this from the goddess Siva. And I took it from him. I thought it was what we all thought. It was a clue, but not the right one. This I am right in. You have the secret of the zombies. Let me have it.
You leave me no choice, my dear Mazovia.
You show rare judgment, my dear Luke.
The secret lies in placing the right hand. So, the symbol of the third eye of Siva. The summoning by will of one who is to be your executioner. His hands slowly steal about your throat. Great priest king Yakavarma used his subjects, men like you, to build the miracle city of Angkor. Perhaps under my control, you are scheduled for even greater things. Dr. Trevisant, I thank you for reinstating me, so kind. And you, my poor friends, for the unwilling contribution of your souls. You are giving me power to achieve the one thing I want. And I am so grateful. No doubt you would all tear me limb from limb should I ever relinquish this control. But that shall never be.
Sensed a change in him when he sent me away.
I'm frightened.
That time Armand was away, he was in Angkor. He's succeeded where we've all failed. He's found the secret of the high priest and he has power. And both of us taught him the lesson of being ruthless. He knows what he wants, all right. It's you.
But what will he do to you?
He'll get me out of the way. Our only chance is to get away together, and right now. Come on.
Your father asked me to say that he wishes to see you at once. I trust you had a pleasant trip to... Where was it? Oh, yes, Ishtala, I believe.
That trip couldn't possibly have been made at your suggestion, could it?
My suggestion? What possible reason could I have had for that?
Same reason as for all these changes have been made since I was sent over for these men and your scheme to marry Claire.
If anything or anyone gets in your way, ride roughshod over him. Isn't that your creed?
Not creed. Just advice I gave to a friend.
You also advised forget sentiment. If you want a thing, go after it and get it. Isn't that it?
You've proved an apt pupil.
I had a splendid teacher.
And now I'm the one that stands in your way.
You are. But I'm removing you.
Lehigh Then if I marry you, you will send Cliff back to England. That is your offer, is it not?
Not my offer. My promise.
He goes unharmed.
Unharmed?
I want your word that you will not make him subject to your will as these others are. These
followers, shall we say. He will not be harmed. I give you my word.
I believe that you will keep it.
Yes, I will. And I'll do more. I'll let you bid him goodbye.
I should like to do that.
You love him very much, don't you?
I'm proving it. It isn't easy to give up the one thing in the world one loves.
No, it isn't, is it? I too love only one thing in the world, but cannot give it up. Our difference is, I haven't your courage.
There's so much I wanted to say. Now there's so little to say.
I've only felt like this once before. The first time I went up into the front lines. I was afraid.
It takes a brave man to say that.
A brave man would never let you sacrifice yourself to save him.
Well, there's no sacrifice. I love you. I shall always love you. Say goodbye.
No. Just let me look at you.
I'll miss my guide.
Oh, we've got to keep our heads up.
I'm going in now. Stop.
10 minutes past five.
From now on, I shall always count time as London.
And mine will always be set 8 hours later, toward the east.
An apt pupil. Your teacher commends you. At least I let her remember you as a man.
If I'm not welcome, open the door again. Start me and I'll roll gently back to my room.
They'll never kill your spirit, MacDonald.
It's all I have left, save my love for my friend.
What's on your mind?
That which is most difficult to do, and have it understood. Give unwanted advice.
That's true, Mac. But go ahead. You're the one man I'll listen to.
Thanks.
Well, what's it all about?
You and yours. You've done a terrible thing to her.
Is it so terrible to fight for and to get the one thing in this world you want?
Not if you played a gentleman's game.
I don't like sermons.
Nor perhaps the truth?
Perhaps not.
I do. This power which you have, this obsession which drives you on, will defeat you in the end, and it should. You fool yourself with the delusion that you can make this woman love you. You can't do it. No man should do what his sense of right tells him not to do, nor desire that which it forbids him to desire. When right ways disappear, one's person must vanish with one's principles. That was said by an ancient philosopher, and I hold these things to be true.
My dearest, know that I love you. Loving each other, we are no farther apart than our thoughts could reach.
Claire, I've just been told that my hope of having you care for me is a delusion. Would you say that?
I married you. I kept my bargain.
And I kept mine.
For that I am grateful.
Is that all I'm to ever have? Your gratitude?
Yes.
I envy Clifford. I'd give up everything I have if you could just find it in your heart to think kindly of me.
You ask me to think kindly of you. You have control over my thinking. You've proved that with my father and others. You've made them subject to your will.
I could never do that to you. I couldn't. If I give up this power, if I release these people,
then I should really believe that you love me.
I'll prove it. I give it up. I love you.
wondered once how the great priest-king Yakov Varman lost his power, releasing his subjects. He was enamored of the fair Indra. He did try by sundry means to win her love. But she, as women will, could not care for him. So he willingly gave up his power for this woman he loved.
There we are, creeps. It was short, but I know it felt like forever. This film is kind of a mess, isn't it? And we can't even blame that on its previously mentioned legal troubles. Revolt of the Zombies received even harsher and more negative reviews from critics than its predecessor, White Zombie, did. Folklore historian and author Peter Dendel, writing for the Zombie Movie Encyclopedia, called the film an uninvolving follow-up that could not have been saved by Lugosi's presence. And Zombie Movies, The Ultimate Guide author Glenn Kay wrote, "There is no experimentation here, only dull composition and flatly lit shots of yakking characters in a by-the-numbers plot." Well, despite the original and more modern reviews, however, the film does have a bit of a cult following, though nothing close to White Zombie's influence on popular culture. And only one actor in this film would continue working steadily for the rest of his life. Most of the cast seems to have retired in the 40s or 50s, but not Dean Jagger. Dean went on to appear in films and TV until 1985, 6 years before his death at the age of 81. He was in everything, from westerns to film noir. He was even in a Bruce Lee movie. But most people will know him as the honored Major General Thomas F. Waverly from the classic musical White Christmas. Ugh. It's too early to be talking about Christmas. It's bad enough that winter popped its ugly head around here in May. Well, that's about all the time that we have tonight. Thank you for joining me on tonight's episode of Damien's Dreadfuls, Boils and Ghouls. As always, I have been your ever so charming host, Lord Damian MacDonovan. I hope to see you next time. But until then, have a ghastly evening.